Yeah, it's my pleasure now to introduce the next speaker, Professor Ravit Helet, who is Professor for Astrophysics at the University of Zurich and has taught in many other places, getting her PhD from Tel Aviv University on the topic the formation of Jupiter. When we sat together a year ago, actually, to figure out what topic which we could do next year, namely now, and talking about gravity and grace, it was immediately clear that we would also need, beyond speakers from the world of culture, visual culture, poetry, we would also need somebody who really knows something about gravity. And we're super happy that Ravit Helet accepted our invitation, and I would like to invite you to the podium. Thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you for having me here. So I'm a scientist. It's I never speak to this type of an audience, so I hope it's going to work well. I should also say that for me, gravity is really, really graceful. If you just think about galaxies and stars and planets, for me, this is really top of graceful images. Okay, so today I'm really going to concentrate on the planet Jupiter, which is a giant planet in the solar system, and you can already imagine that gravity is a very important force there. But we will really keep it very low in the science, and I'll try to enhance the art aspect here. So this is our solar system. So this is our planetary neighborhood, if you wish. So our solar system has 8 planets, because Pluto is no longer a planet. We have 4 terrestrial planets and 4 giant planets. So this is our home. And doing planetary science on a daily lifetime basically puts you things in perspective that we are really negligible. Here you can also see the distances to scale. And these are the planets in the solar system to scale. So you can see that really Earth is very small, and actually the planetary system we live in is dominated by the gas giant planets. So how do we really define gas giant planets? Well, these are planets that are much more massive than the Earth. In terms of mass, Jupiter has more than 300 times the mass of the Earth, so it's a much larger object. And also the composition of this planet is very different. It's really mostly hydrogen and helium, a little bit more similar to the composition of the Sun. In general, in the universe, the materials that are common are hydrogen and helium, not the materials we are thinking about or we are made of, which are the heavier elements like carbon and oxygen and so on. So in the solar system, as I said, so we have these two giant planets, it's Jupiter and Saturn, then we have Uranus and Neptune that are slightly smaller. But there are other planetary systems. Now we know that planets are actually very common astrophysical objects. This is actually a change of paradigm which is relatively new that happened in 1995, when actually Swiss astronomers discovered the first planets orbiting around another star which is similar to the Sun. So now we know that the galaxy is essentially full of planets. So if you just think about our galaxy, we have 400 billion stars. On average, each star should have a planet. If you think about life in the universe, or the uniqueness of our existence here, as I said, it really puts things in perspective. So Jupiter. So again, just to get a feeling for what kind of an object it is, which is, I think, really very graceful. So it's very massive, as I said, it's more than 300 times the mass of the Earth. It's much further from the Sun, so we are defined as one astronomical unit from the Sun, and this is 5 times more. So Jupiter is 5 times more distant from the Sun. It's also large. 10 times more the size of the Earth. It has no surface because, you know, it's a gas giant planet. It's hydrogen helium. So it's not that you can go and step on Jupiter. It's not going to work. And it's also a very fast rotator. So if you have something which is very massive and rotates really fast, you can already think about this, imagine very nice dynamics that we expect to have in this planet, which we actually see. So here you can see a movie from the Voyager mission, so that was taken in the 79, and you can really see these beautiful features on the planet, and you can really see these movements. You see all this turbulence, you see the storms. This is something which is very special when it comes to GEM planet. And we are still trying to answer the questions of what drives this weather system and also how deep these winds go in such planets. But we also have to keep in mind that these images that we see, so images, they tell us a lot, but we cannot probe the deep interior of this planet. So what is it in, like, inside? We don't have seismology like we have on the Earth, so we have to make models to try to understand how the planet looks like from the inside. So I'm spending a lot of time trying to solve this question. So we think that Jupiter beneath the star has a region that it has molecular hydrogen, and deeper inside, where you have really high pressures and temperature, hydrogen becomes metallic, so it's like really conductive, like a metal. That also generates its very strong magnetic field, and maybe it has a core in the center, but this is something we are still debating. Okay. And because we really want to understand this nature of this planet, there was a planning of a mission, so a Juno mission, so this was approved and was launched in 2011. So this is a mission that is dedicated to study Jupiter. Basically, we want to understand the gravity, so the gravitational field of the planet, its magnetic field, as I said, its dynamics, how deep it goes, and also its aurora. Here you can see the spacecraft to scale of a person. So, well, I hope it's impressive for you. Here you can see the walk of the, again, on the spacecraft. So that was before the launch. As I said, the launch was in 2011. Here you can see a simulation of the orbit. So basically, the spacecraft has to leave the Earth. So you can see Earth. So these are the orbits of the other planets. And here you can see Juno. Then in 2012, there was a deep space maneuver coming back to meet the Earth to get a push of gravity, to get a gravity assist, we call it. So you can see here. And then the spacecraft continues until it meets Jupiter. And actually, this journey is quite long because you want the spacecraft to come in a relatively low velocity so it can get captured in the gravitational field of the planet. So you can see it's coming relatively slowly, and then it is captured. So as we speak now, basically, the Juno spacecraft is orbiting Jupiter. So this is the official video of
in
the launch.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ignition and liftoff of the Atlas V with Juno on a trek to Jupiter, a planetary piece of the puzzle on the beginning of our solar system.
HR roll program is in progress. Vehicle pod rates look good.
So if you're a space engineering, this moment is really exciting and graceful for you to see this thing going up and leaving the Earth, going, exploring another planetary object. So, as I said, this is the official NASA movie of Juno leaving the Earth. I was there with my family. It was a different experience, but also very grateful. Graceful, you can see it here. So that was taking, the video was taken by a colleague of mine. So we had to be far away, because of course it's dangerous to be very close to the rocket. But it was really, really exciting. So you have to look here, you will see. You see here? So we were all really, really excited. Very graceful moment for us. So another moment that I remember is when we were there, I was there with my daughter, who was 5 at the time. And after this, the rocket left, she told me, "Hey, mom, can we come again tomorrow?" I'm like, no. Okay. So, as I said, I'm a scientist. So, this mission is really concentrated on the science to get accurate measurements of the gravitational field, magnetic field, and so on. In my research, as I said, I'm interested in the internal structure of Jupiter, trying to answer whether it has a core of heavy elements or not. What is the structure looking like? Is it differentiated like the Earth that we have layering or not? We are learning as time progresses and the mission progresses, we learn many things. By now we know that Jupiter has a very complex internal structure that really opens up to many, many new questions in terms of the science. So keep tuned, I'm sure you will see it in the media. And in addition to the science instruments, there is actually a camera on Juno. And the reason for this camera was actually public outreach. And the idea is to make the public involved in the mission to try to reach to everybody. So there is a small camera. It has 4 filters, red, green, blue, and near infrared. And all the images are processed by amateurs, so by amateur astronomers. This is has nothing to do with the science. We are not part of this processing. And by now, we have over than 60,000 images that were taken with this camera. So I'm going to show you these images. Maybe before that, yeah, it's important to say that this is really the first time that we have these really high-resolution images of Jupiter, including the polar regions of the planet, that until these missions were really unknown. We didn't know how they look like, and this was surprising. So here you can see Jupiter in ring color. You can see that it has a pastel color, but nevertheless, you can see this very nice turbulent regions in the planets. It shows you that, again, if you're looking from far, it looks very calm, but of course, the motions are very impressive, very strong. And here you can see the differences between the real color and the enhanced colors. Again, because these images are processed by amateur astronomers, they really play with the colors. And the nice thing is that even though it's not real color, you can really see the features really, really well. So here you can see this comparison. And I think it's really, really impressive to see all these small features and dynamics of this really beautiful planet. So again, here you can see the south pole of Jupiter. This is in ring color. And here you can see the enhanced color picture. So again, with Juno, that was the first time that we actually got these images of the poles, and we see that they are very, very complex with a lot of dynamics. Again, this is not real color, but it's really, really nice. So we also get images of the Great Red Spot. This is the spot that you have on the planet that should be there already for 300 years, probably more. It was just detected 300 years ago. So this is like a huge storm that is still ongoing. So we also have images of that. And the reason that I thought that talking about Jupiter is appropriate here, because I found this quote in space.com that says that JunoCam images, our science meets art, and NASA meets the public. And I thought that this is really nice and really true. So here you see Van Gogh's picture, Starry Night. And here you can see Juno images in the background. So for me, it looks very, very artistic. Okay, we try once more. So you can see Claude Monet, the water lilies. And this is Jupiter's Great Red Spot. And this is also taking Juno data, so the picture images data, and just try to make something artistic out of that. So for those of you here who are dealing with image processing, you can really take the data and you can manipulate it as much as you want. And I think we can really get lots of nice artistic features from that. So I will finish with a movie. So this movie is composed of 21 images. So we are basically flying through the poles of Jupiter. And hopefully it will show you that gravity is very, very graceful. there will be a feature that looks like a dolphin swimming in the clouds of Jupiter.
Thank you very much for this wonderful presentation. We have about 10 minutes for questions before the coffee break. Questions? Yeah, I will start so that you can think of the second questions, because I have only one questions in reserve. Astrophysics is something which this is probably also because it's so quiet, everybody feels kind of attracted, because we all like to look at the sky, but also, of course, incompetent, because we don't understand anything about it, most of us. So, but it has to do with I'm sure, with the attraction of the sky and some gravity that works. So could you describe how you got attracted by planets?
So just like you said, so I think when I was young, of course it's easy to say now looking retroactive, but I always thought it's really special. So I looked above, and just even just the, you know, when you see clouds and you see the sun and you see the moon and you see the stars. And actually I experienced it yesterday, because it was a very clear night and we were just in the mountains. You just look and say, wow, this is the best place to be an astrophysicist. Actually, it's here. I mean, it's really an amazing feeling. So for me, I really just, yeah, it's really fascinating. Then I was kind of lucky as a student in high school to study physics, but also literature, and get to know the topic. And yeah, and then when I started studying that, it was just like, wow, this is the most interesting thing ever. So I think it has a little bit of, you know, bad reputation. I mean, we have this imagination of scientists or physicists, they are a given type of people. I think it's a little bit old-fashioned. I think if people find this topic interesting, they should definitely try. It's not as complicated as it may seem. Really not.
Why is it so important to know about the core of Jupiter?
Good question, yeah. So so there are two answers for that. So one thing is because we think that if we know whether Jupiter has a core or not, it tells us something about the formation process of the planet. So basically there are competing models for giant planet formation, and one argues that you need to have a core in order to accrete the hydrogen and helium to form a gas giant planet in the first place, while the other one says that you just have a gravitational instability in a disk where planets form, and then you don't need a core. So although the core, essentially in terms of the mass, it's a very small percentage, it's not even, maybe it's 5% of the total mass, even less. For us, it's critical because it tells us something about the formation process of planets. And of course, again, even if you're not a scientist, I think understanding the formation of planetary systems, to understand how we got here, puts it in perspective, our place in the universe. For me, it also touches really philosophical questions. Meet Jupiter, yeah? So this is a bit of, a little bit arbitrary. Well, when I was a student, it was my first year of studying, and I took a class, and it was Introduction to Planetary Science, which was a little bit about the solar system. And the person who taught this class, who then later was my PhD advisor, his PhD, which was in the, I don't know, 70s, 60s, was about Jupiter. And somewhat, he was really excited about this planet. And it was very mild, but I think I could feel this excitement. And for me, it was, wow, this is such a beautiful planet. This is so interesting. You know, you see all these features. It's so large. I mean, it's the first planet to form in the system. It really controls the dynamics of planetary systems. For example, we think that 30% of the water we have on the Earth came because Jupiter excited comets that came to the inner part of the solar system. So of course now I have all the answers, the scientific reasons to study that, because it's really an amazing planet. But for me it was really, but you see, it was somewhat, yeah, very impressive for me as a student, yeah. And I still hold this opinion.
I'm sure you cannot answer my question, but the Earth is a very small star in the total of the space. Have you any idea that there is just life on Earth? Funny.
That's like a few billion dollar questions. I mean, we are working on that. But I can say that on average now, as I said, when we discovered in 95 the first planets around another star, now we know of more than 4,000 planets like that. And another thing we learned, that actually small planets like the Earth are much more common than Jupiter-like planets. So in terms of statistics, as I said, if we know that around, on average, around every star there is a planet, and it's more likely to be a small planet, you can do the math and say that probably there is life out there. But again, we are really now making efforts to detect it. It's very hard to detect it directly, so we are doing it with indirect methods, but this is really a blossoming field of exoplanets and habitability, so we are looking at that, and hopefully, actually we are living in a very special time, because I think in the next decade or two, we are really going to have a definite answer to your questions.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thomas Hirschhorn told us that there is a moment of, can happen, a moment of grace in art when you lose control, when you're working with something too big. You know? Grace is also related to mysticism, to religion, usually not to hardcore scientific experimentation, but still, would there, in your view, besides the rocket leaving, is there moments of grace in the daily life of the scientist?
Yeah, so when I was asked this question, and you can find it in the magazine, for me it's really my everyday life, I feel like that. Just because for us, by default, every day you feel very small. Just because you know that you are really negligible in terms of, you know, the universe, the lifetime we have, the time we have on the Earth is really small compared to the age of the universe. So everything is in perspective. And the fact that I can explore these interesting objects every day, for me, I really feel it on a daily basis. Yeah.
Thank you very much for this fantastic voyage.